we've unashamedly been kind of taking this focus on the value of being single, right? Why it's important. We looked at Paul's words last week in the book of 1 Corinthians. And so we're kind of, this relationship series, we do it every year. Why? Because this is an important piece of your life right now. But oftentimes we focus on what, you know, kind of the whole gambit of what does healthy relationships look like over the whole series. Well, this year, we're doing it in one talk, this talk. So I'm going to try to get it as complete as physically possible in about 25, 30 minutes. And hopefully you guys can track with me. But I want to put a little, just kind of something out there before we get going. This will not answer all your questions, I can assure you. Also, we are going to have a panel. You're going to be able to ask any questions you want next week. Anything related in the series or unrelated we've talked about. And I'm not sure. Oh, you're giving me the sign. Look at that back there. They're saying if you haven't signed up for small group, take it back now and do that so they can organize that. Anyways. Now they lost. Look at what you guys did. Oh, yeah. This is where I was going. We're going to have a panel next week. And so you guys say that on the pinned at the top of the U-Life group is a little one-question survey. It's anonymous, so don't be afraid to put a question on there. And we can't necessarily guarantee your question, but we're going to try to answer as many as we can. The only reason we wouldn't is honestly for time, not because we're afraid of your question. But also, if you have any interest, whether you're single or in a relationship, I want to throw this out there. Have you guys heard of the book Love and Respect? You guys know that book?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. It's a very good book. Simple premise, really, but the book is quite thick. But there's a DVD curriculum that goes with this idea, and it talks about kind of what we're talking about today. What does healthy relationships, healthy dating, marriage, etc. look like? And so if you're interested in learning more, I'm willing to kind of assemble a, you know, I don't know how long. I'm going to put a survey out on Facebook and see if anybody's interested. But it'd be a different night than Tuesday. And it would only last, you know, from 4 weeks, I'm guessing, for about an hour at a time. So if you're interested, just know that that's coming. Be looking for that. So anyways, here we are, kind of picking up. I'm going to try to cover the whole gambit of relationships here in one night. And I thought about all the different ways we do it. In fact, I was talking to Mackenzie, and I'm like, you know, I'm not really sure what this talk is going to be like yet. I've talked about this at least 100 times, probably a lot more. Not necessarily upfront talking to people, but definitely I've had so many of these conversations one-on-one with people in coffee shops or in the church or wherever. And so I feel like I have a lot to say and not enough time to say it. And so bear with me on all of this. But this is kind of the angle I decided to take tonight. And how many of you guys know what the journalistic six are, or the journalistic questions? All right, so you have some, maybe journalism majors, or have you just heard that phrase? What are they?
Who,
very good. Who, what, when, where, why, how. All right, so tonight, we're going to kind of approach what does a healthy dating relationship look like based on those. And so this is going to be, like I said, it's going to be a flying pace here. But we're going to start at what? What is dating? And I don't think I have to speak a lot to what that is. I think you have a decent idea what dating is. And the one thing that comes to my mind first is like that, you know, Mark and Holly sitting in a tree, K-S-S-I-N-G, first comes love, then comes marriage. Comes baby in the baby. You know, that's the whole process, right? This is what we're talking about, dating. So that's kind of what I'm going to speak about. The one thing I'm going to speak to the what. Because you guys have an idea what this is, and there's probably all kinds of stuff you could say about it. But for our purposes tonight, the one thing I'm going to focus on is that dating is a part of a process. Oftentimes, we think of dating as something isolated in activity, or that can stand alone, if you will. And I'm going to elaborate on this a little bit. But sometimes when, you know, if we were to describe dating, it could be like this. Well, today, you know, you're talking to your buddy in the morning or something. Today, you know, I'm going to go work out for a while. I've got some classes. Going to do some homework. And then after that, I'm going to go on a date. Right? And just kind of leave it in its own little lane. And my argument here is that dating, we cannot allow in our minds to let it sit by itself like that. The equivalent, what I would say to make sense of this, is we wouldn't say, well, I'm gonna go work out, I'm gonna go to my classes, do a little homework, and stir tonight. That makes no sense, right? Stirring is very much a verb that only applies in the context of cooking, or if you're a witch, mixing your brew, or something like that. But it always exists as a part of a process. It's useless by itself most of the time. And I want to argue that dating is the same way. That oftentimes we very flippantly speak of dating as just this casual activity that we embark upon, but it's not. It is a part of a process we call marriage. It's one step on that continuum. And so, before I go kind of any further, that's what I want to express tonight. What is dating? Dating is a step on the process of marriage, and that alone. And there really shouldn't be casual dating, as they say. And I'm not saying as soon as you date somebody, you have to marry them. That's not what I'm saying. But I'm saying there should be a purpose behind your dating to perhaps marry that person. If you look at that person right now and you're thinking, I would never marry him, or I would never marry her, then you're probably in the wrong relationship. I'm just saying. And I'm going to bring a lot more like that tonight. I'm going to tell you all the things you're doing wrong. So get ready.
Thanks, Mom.
So that's kind of the what, all right? That's the what of dating. I'm going to try to move fast. The next one, and probably the most important question, is why. Why date? Why in the world do we do this thing called dating? You know, you look back several hundred years ago, dating didn't exist. It was, you know, mom and dad found some lucky person for you, and they just sold you off, you know? And that's kind of how marriage works. It's a unique phenomenon that we have this thing called dating. Why do we do it? Well, I'm going to kind of turn back this, and there's a lot of, like, still right answers, but a little bit shallower ways you could answer that. But I'm going to go probably straight to the core of this. And I'm going to answer this through actually an old doctrinal statement. And some of you might be familiar with the Westminster Confessions or Catechisms. How many of you guys have even heard that phrase before? A couple, all right? Don't feel bad if you haven't. They're old, all right? So what these are is these were a collection, basically exactly what they sound like, catechisms, teachings, or confessions of faith that were done in 1646. And the purpose of these were a bunch of really good theologians got together and said, we want to create some agreement around doctrine and theology based on the Bible. It's not like something they just got out of thin air. This is very much based on the Bible. But they wanted to do it in order to unite the faith, specifically in this case in Europe. And so the reason I say that is because oftentimes in our culture here, especially if you do or don't have a Catholic background, our kind of Western Protestant reaction is if it sounds liturgical or if it sounds doctrinal, it's evil, right? This is not true. It's not evil. These are actually very good men, Protestant men actually, that came up with this. And it doesn't mean it's on the same level of Scripture. It just means these are very well-tested statements of faith. And so we're going to turn to, it's actually in the Shorter Catechism, which was meant to kind of instruct young people and kids too. But it does this really simple Q&A. I would encourage you to look it up. There's a bunch of them if you have some simple questions about the faith. But it's the first question of this catechism. It says, what is the chief end of man? And the answer to that is man's chief end is to glorify God and enjoy Him forever. It's that simple. So if we're talking about the purpose of marriage, it's the same, actually. The purpose of marriage, just like our very existence, should be to glorify God and enjoy Him forever. If we're not doing that, then we're not dating for the right reasons. We're not in the relationship for the right reasons. And again, these didn't just come out of thin air. I've got some verses that I'll read to you guys just to kind of show the support behind them. But 1 Corinthians 6, 19-20, and we've been in these passages. You've heard this before. This is Paul speaking again. He says, do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit, who is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not your own. You were bought at a price. therefore honor God with your bodies. He's saying, make your life, make your existence, use your bodies for my glory. Philippians 3:8 says, what is more, I consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them garbage, that I may gain Christ. He's putting things into perspective. This is Paul again saying, all the other things in the world is garbage compared to knowing and being in a relationship with Christ. This is the same for relationships. This is the same Paul who was blasting marriage we were talking about last week. It's not that he hates marriage or hates married people. He understands perspective, and he understands knowing Christ and being in Christ is far more than anything we could gain on this earth. Romans 12:1 says, therefore I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. This is how we're to live our lives for God. This is our purpose of existence, to use our bodies and our lives to worship and glorify Him. Same. Again, relationships. Our very existence, our very being in a relationship should be to please and honor God and use that as a form of worship. And then last, I'm going to show you Joshua 24:15. I'm going to show you that one because this is true all over in the Old Testament. In Psalms, we see it as well. In Psalms 34:7, I don't have that one up here, but it says, delight in the Lord, and He'll give you the desires of your heart. This is the verse that basically John Piper, if you've never heard of him, great theologian, has built this thing he calls Christian hedonism on. Hedonism, if you guys don't know what that means, that literally means the pursuit of pleasure. Usually is a bad thing. But he talks about this Christian hedonism, how God created us to enjoy Him. And when we're truly seeking Him out, He gives us the desires of our heart, and therefore we seek Him more. This is how this life looks. Joshua 24:15, Joshua is the guy who took Moses' spot. Moses led the Israelites out of Egypt, did all that. Joshua was the one who carried the torch across the Jordan, right? And this is at the end of Joshua's life, who inherited this legacy and this responsibility behind Moses. And there's a bit of some contention going on at the end of his life, and Joshua's having some final words with these guys, with his tribes, and he says, but if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourself this day whom you will serve. Whether gods your ancestors served beyond the Euphrates or gods of the Amorites in whose land you are living. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. He just threw down. They're all debating on who they're going to worship and this and that after God had delivered them several times. And he's saying, you know what? You guys do what you want, but I'm going to worship the Lord. His very life, all the way to the very end, was committed to following Him and making everything he did about the worship and service of God. This is our point in dating. This is why. Our dating should exist to glorify God. If you find yourself desiring to date to fill some kind of void, some loneliness, a hole, some sadness, or because your friends are all dating and you just want something to do on a Friday night, or whatever it is, it's the wrong reason. You should be going into it knowing this is somebody, one, that I see I could potentially marry, and two, that I want to be in a relationship because I'm pretty sure they would help me glorify God better. I'm pretty sure they would challenge me in my faith. That would require a lot out of them. That would require that they're actually pretty solid in their faith, that they're really worshiping, that their life isn't just about dating. So we're going to get to that in a little bit. But that's it. I mean, our sole reason, I think I got a slide up there, for getting into a relationship should be to deepen our relationship with Christ. I'm going to read again. Our sole reason for getting into a relationship should be to deepen our relationship with Christ. That's it. I know this is true after being married. I've had many relationships that were not that. And they were all about me and all about what I wanted. But I know when I got involved with Mackenzie, I wasn't looking for Mackenzie, actually. I wasn't looking for anybody. And I think that's sometimes the best sign. We're going to talk about that too. But what I did after just spending a little time around her, I realized she encouraged me and she challenged me towards the Lord. And that's what made me most excited about her, honestly. So that's the second question. We got what? We got why. The third question is when. When? We touched on this a little bit. The short answer to this is when you are ready. That's when you should be dating. How do you know when you're ready? You know when you're ready when you know yourself. How do you know when you know yourself? That's the big question, honestly. Will you ever know yourself fully, be fully aware of who you are? Yes, in heaven. Not here. But I can assure you that you can get a very good understanding of yourself while here on earth. And the way you do that is spending time in God's Word. Who we are is in relationship to Christ. We are nothing outside of Him. And so everything about us needs to be compared to who He is and who He says we are. And that's who we know we are. And as a part of that process, we get to know about those deeper things that make us tick. We get to know more about ourselves. You have those epiphany moments where you're just like, oh yeah, I didn't even realize that about me. I didn't realize I always do this when this happens. Or I didn't realize that I always go running to this when this bad situation arises. It's the self-awareness that helps you know who you are. Why do you need to know who you are? How in the world are you ever going to be in a good dating relationship if you don't know who you are? Because if you don't know who you are, you surely don't know who that guy is or that girl is you're with. And you definitely don't know if they're going to be good for you. You don't know if they can help you or hurt you or encourage you or bring you down in your faith. And so you have to know that. And again, this is not an easy question to settle. When am I ready? When do I know myself well enough? But one good test for this is if I asked you right now, are you ready to date? Assuming you're single. And you told me, yes, I am. That to me says, you're not ready. Because if you're truly self-aware, you know you're a mess and you know you never want to bring somebody into your mess. Right? The funny thing about it is that sometimes God does that, and honestly, most times, most people you talk to that are in really healthy relationships, it usually starts like, yeah, I wasn't even looking, and ... Because they know themselves well enough to know, you know, I'm just trying to get this life right by myself. I don't need to drag somebody into my junk. And you go into it that attitude, then you're on the right feet. So, again, that's a whole series on identity and how do you figure that out? How do you know yourself? So we'll just move on from there. My next question, so we're going through these journalistic questions. What do you guys think the next question is?
Why?
Why? Very good. Some people cheated because we had a little prep meeting. They're not that smart, trust me. The next question is why? We want to move right on to like, okay, we got when down, now who? Who's it going to be? Who's it going to be? Tell me, God, I want to know who I'm going to marry tonight. After you go through this process of figuring out, you know, when, and maybe you really have a good sense, like, you know, I know I'm not perfect, but I got a sense of who I am, therefore who I need in my life. We want to move right to that who I need right away, but we have to constantly go back to that question why again. Why am I dating? Why am I looking today? Why the heck am I thinking about this right now? Am I lonely? Am I feeling in need of something? Am I whatever? Fill in the blank at the end. But you have to keep going back to that why question, have to keep addressing it in your life. And, you know, when it comes down to it, if you think, again, what I'm saying, if you think you're ready and you start going looking for somebody, that why question is going to be real pertinent. Because we should be saying, but why am I looking for somebody? Do I not trust God? Do I not think He's got somebody for me? Do I not think that somebody's going to want me at some point? Like, why am I trying to micromanage this situation? Why am I going to search? Or maybe somebody's kind of coming after you and you're not really expecting it. Then you can ask that when question and you think, oh, okay, I'm okay here. But still ask, why would I go into this relationship? Is it to glorify Christ, or is it to just experiment with dating? You know? So ask that question yourself. Then moving on to the next question. Then you can go into the who. This is really, really, really important. Again, I keep saying it because I want you guys not to forget it. I think this is the second most important decision you'll ever make. Beyond your relationship with Christ, this relationship will ruin your life or make it the best decision you've ever made. And so you have to know who. You have to make a good decision. Going back, we're building here. You cannot know who that other person is unless you know who you are. That's that when we talked about. But you have to know how to pick them, right? And one of the things I like to have people do is I like to say, considering you know yourself pretty well, what do you need? What do you need in a mate? What do you need for you to support you in a relationship in life, for life? And I ask them to make a list. And one of two things can happen. They either have like three things on there, like, well, I guess, like, he needs to be nice, and she needs to be good looking, and, you know, maybe smell good. I don't know. Like, no, those are pretty shallow. But my point is sometimes we just have a few things. What that tells me is your bar is really low. And it shouldn't be. That's a terrible thing to get into. If your bar is low, you're in trouble. That's what I'm saying. If your bar is low, you probably don't know yourself very well, and you don't know who Jesus Christ says you are in relationship to him. Your son, his son, or his daughter, an heir to the kingdom. Or you get somebody on the way other side, and they describe Jesus. They're waiting. This is good. It's good to have a high bar. But you have to also understand people are imperfect. So I like to find something in the middle there. You have to figure out what are those non-negotiables. Those non-negotiables should be that, not that they're just a Christian, but their life, they're passionately pursuing God in their life. And you know that that's sincere. It's not like, wow, I'm going to passionately pursue God as long as she's here. You know, it can't be that. It has to be sincere. It has to be proven. How do you know if it's proven if you've only known him for 3 weeks? You don't. All right? You just don't. So it's really important that you know who these people are and you have a reasonable set of expectations. You know, some of the things God's going to mess with you on, like some of the things he might say, you know, if you're convinced you want to marry a blonde-headed woman, he might just have a sense of humor and have you marry a brunette. You might have to convince her to dye her hair. I don't know. But other things, he's going to be, even the littlest things he's going to address. One of the things that I remember, I don't know why, I'm crazy in retrospect, but I remember thinking, like early in college, because I had met and known a lot of girls in sororities, and I really enjoyed hanging around with them. They were just fun. They were just lighthearted and knew how to just relax and have fun. And I remember thinking, I might even said it to a friend, like, I think I'm going to marry a sorority girl, which is should be a death sentence, really. I don't mean that to be harsh. I just mean that because, ironically, God did do that. Mackenzie was a sorority girl, and I love her for it. I love her bubbliness and her joy and her excitement and her willingness to want to just gather people around her and get other people excited. But that's what I saw in that persona that I loved. And so a lot of those little things God will actually address and give you if you're patient, if you wait. So that's the who. We could spend all day on that stuff. But, you know who you are before you bring somebody else into it. Because if you don't know who you are and you have these sudden bursts of like rage or anxiety or sudden swings of depression, how are they going to know how to deal with you if you don't even know how to deal with you? Quite honestly, you are not picking the right person because you don't even know who that person is that you need to support you. So next question, what do you think?
Why?
Very good. Now you're catching it. You have to go back. Okay, I think it's the right time. I think this might be a good person, but why would I enter into a dating relationship with them? Why would I pursue marriage? You have to go back to that over and over again. Is it to glorify God? Is it to make my life and body worship? To be my holy sacrifice? Is that why I would do this? After you've done that, then you kind of move back to the last step. How? How do you do this? This is the very practical part. Okay, all these things are in line. Now, how do you actually go about dating? How do you start this thing? How do you talk to them? How do you ask them on a date or whatever it is? These are all the practical pieces in that. I'm not going to get too overly practical today. If you want some ideas, I can give them to you. They won't be like, they're not foolproof, trust me. But I can give you some ideas on some of the practical stuff. But I'm going to lean more towards another direction and read you some verses here. And the first one is Ephesians 5, 1 through 3. It says, follow God's example, therefore, as dearly loved children, and walk in the way of love. Just as Christ loved us and gave himself for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. But among you there must not even be a hint of sexual immorality or any kind of impurity or of greed, because these are improper for God's holy people. We have to actually live life like we love them, right? And he's saying, don't let these things come in. Impurity, immorality, all these things. Moving on, John 13, 34 through 35. A new command I give you, love one another as I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. And I'm going to get into the why behind all this in a second. And Philippians 2, 3 through 8 says, and you've seen the first part of this, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourself, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of the others. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature of God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. This is how we do relationships. We humble ourselves and we make ourselves servants to the person that we are actually in a relationship with. It says, do it as Christ did it, that he lowered himself to the depths of servant to the God as God, all the way to his death. He said, I love this section in there. He did not consider equality with God something to be used to his advantage. How often in a relationship do we find advantage points? Unintentionally, sometimes intentionally. Where our purpose is to get something, to somehow manipulate, to somehow work our way into something that our desired outcome, whatever that outcome may be. The bottom line is, if you want to know how to do a relationship well, always think about what do they need before you think about what do I need or what do I want. And I think, you know, most of our problems and mistakes will always trace back to selfishness. The selfishness happens because we're not in tune with God usually. We're kind of not paying attention or turning our back on God in some way. And that pride is stirring, that manipulation is stirring, that selfishness is stirring, and then we hurt and take advantage of that person. And then it's this downward cycle. Then the other person reacts and doesn't, the other person reacts and doesn't, and so on, etc. So this is how you do a relationship well. This is not practical, but this is very right and theoretical. If you want to know how to do a relationship well, think, what do I want? Don't do that. What does she need? Or what does he need? Do that. That's how you do it right. And I would say, for me, the greatest kind of litmus test of, am I doing a relationship right? Assuming all these other things you've chosen are right, right? Think about your the person you're with right now. If you're not with somebody, you can imagine. Now try to imagine them, you're not married to them in the future, but you're married to somebody else. picture that person you're with right now being best friends with your future spouse. Would you be afraid of what they talked about? Would you be ashamed of what they talked about? Would you even let them in the same room? If the answer is no to those, you are doing it wrong. You are allowing bad things to come into the relationship that never belonged there, that weren't honoring God, that were rooted in selfishness, that were rooted in, sin, quite honestly. A lot of those that bring shame is sexual immorality, right? For guys especially, but girls too. For girls, a lot of times what's rooted in that is this emotional attachment or connection you made with that person. You could never imagine your future husband being with them because you would feel almost ashamed that you shared that emotional connection with this person and him, your husband. That's the pain you have to envision. One of the greatest psychologists I really love to follow is Henry Cloud, and he's got this book called like 7 Things You Simply Must Do to Succeed in Life and Love or something like that. And he talks about playing out the real. He says, highly successful, and not successful by money, successful by people who reach their own goals. Highly successful people tend to always play out the future scenario in their heads and say, if I do this, what will happen down the road? If you're doing that in a relationship, you will do it right, I promise. Because if you're thinking about, if I do this, how could it hurt her in a long way? How could it affect my future relationship or my wife, my future wife? Or, in some cases, you know, what if they were kind of friends or in the same spheres? Would I be ashamed to know that they might be talking or what they might say? Was I a bad person? All those things, you got to be able to play that out. If you can play that out, then you're probably going to do the right things in a relationship. We're not going to go into specifics and all that and boundaries. That's a whole nother conversation. But I want you guys to think about that on a base level. And, if you're at that point where you're kind of thinking, this isn't helping, I'm not doing it right, you have some real serious stuff to take care of. Because the way I see it, there's really two options, and that's to end it. Or you have some real serious conversation and do a reboot and a lot of apologies and a lot of communication to get it back on track. Because I'm telling you, there's nothing that'll mess up a marriage more than bringing sin and that crappy stuff into it. And the quick flyby of that, I just want to, a few shout outs to guys, don't manipulate women. I was a master at this game where it's like you try to act real sad and sappy and hope they want to console you with their bodies. This is not a good practice, all right? And it's real. Guys do this stuff. Guys, communicate your intentions. If you're interested in a girl, be interested in a girl. Don't just linger around and not do anything about it, which is kind of the second point. Don't play the stupid coward game of like just flirt with 17 people and wait for somebody to pique an interest. Step up, be a man, and talk to her. Ask her out if you're interested. Girls, don't give those emotional pieces of you away, because you won't ever get them back. I promise. You won't get them back, and you'll regret that you ever did. It's not to say there's not hope for you. That's not what I'm saying. There is healing and there's redemption, but don't go there if you don't need to, if you haven't yet. And the other piece of that, too, is for you women, trust God. I know it's difficult sometimes because you're like, well, the guys are a bunch of schmucks or they're not around. You know, they don't ever do anything, say anything, ask out on any dates or, you know, like most churches I go to, it's like a 3-to-1 ratio. Whatever your reason, trust God. If you really think he's going to hold out on you or not bring somebody great for you, then there's some other issues and you shouldn't even be considering dating, quite honestly. So do that. And for everybody, you know, one of the biggest guides you can do is stop using physical or emotional intimacy to be the bond of the relationship. Make it be spiritual intimacy. We talked about this once before, and one should never be higher than the other, honestly, because they'll all rise in proportion. If you get really physical, they'll all rise up in until you get in a dangerous situation or a situation where you might be involved with somebody that you never intended to be seriously. So that's saying the last step, why again? If you're in a relationship, that's kind of what I was getting at. Ask that question, why am I in it? Should I be in it? Should I do something? Should I get out of this? And honestly, like, I'm really passionate about this, if you can't tell. So if you want advice, or if you sense you're in a not so great situation and want to know what you can do, let me know. And I'd love to talk to you about it. I'd love to talk through some of the ideas and processes and things of that nature. So if it sounds familiar, remember that talk, the mistakes, wrong. You guys remember? Putting you on the spot. Wrong timing, wrong person, wrong approach. Does it sound like when, what, no, when, what's that? When, who, and how, right? So this is the whole deal. This is, you know, the reasons, the ways you make mistakes are also the ways you can make it really successful. So with that said, let's pray. God, thank you for this time. Thank you for everybody in here. I thank you for their willingness to hear. And I pray, God, that the words would go to their heart and that anything not of you would drift away. And God, I just pray that knowing that, and probably many people, that a courageous act needs to happen as a result of what they heard, God, and I pray that you give them the courage to do that and the strength to do that as well. And God, I just pray most of all that their whole purpose would be to glorify you and to figure out how they can draw close to you in this life here on earth, God. And so Lord, I just pray for everybody here, pray that we have great small groups, and ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right, guys, so we're going to, if you care to stay, we're going to break into small groups. Leaders, come stand up here, and if they know where they're going, they can head down. You can tell them which room. If they